Matt Kuperholz. I'm a computer nerd and a maths geek for many years. I guess I'm also a business person, being a partner at Deloitte. And I want to talk to you about some of the projects I've been involved in recently to do with collective action, and in particular under the concept of eating your own dog food, or dog fooding, which is a term that some people have tried to get away from. They said, we can't call it ice creaming or drink your own champagne, but eating your own dog food is stuck. And the etymology of that term is that there was, I hope this is the right story, a famous cowboy actor who did a series of dog food ads for Alpo in the 80s in the States, and he said, you know, it's so good I even feed it to my own dog. But there's another story, which it was a dog food ad. There's another story that the CEO of Calcan Pet Food used to start each board meeting by eating a can of the dog food at the boardroom table. Anyway, it really became popular when there was an internal memo from Microsoft leaked, where they said, you know, we should be using our own software. Why are we developing network software, but you're not using it yourself? So it's really a concept from software companies, but it's something at Deloitte we believe in very strongly, which is if it's good enough for our clients, then it should be good enough for us. You know, we should be selling product that we're happy to use ourselves. So these are three examples around collective action that we're actually doing inside Deloitte, and we're also doing for our clients. And they're all a little bit interrelated, hopefully not too tangential. And the first one we've heard a bit about today, so crowdsourcing, and in particular crowdsourcing of analytics. We're also going to talk about social capital and the concept of optimising social capital by using tools, and in fact, what is social capital? Leading into an initiative called As One, which is the topic of this book, and something I was very proud and happy to be involved with over the last couple of years. So let's start with a question. I'm biased with regard to the answer to this question. What is the sexiest job in the next 10 years going to be? Is it a photographer? You're all creative folk. Is it going to be something exciting and sexy like that? Well, actually, the common thinking at the moment is, believe it or not, it's true. And why is this true? Well, we've talked about all these fantastic electronic mediums that are generating all this ability to collaborate and work collectively. They're also generating a ton of data. It's one of the only things we're not running out of. It's one of the only things we're making so much more of. And in this data is value. And what I do all day, every day, is create value from data assets. So data is going to find its way into every walk of life and business, which is why people who can make sense of it are going to be in high demand in the years to come. So let's start with the crowdsourcing example. In particular with regard to data analytics, and this was probably most famously begun a couple of years ago, where Netflix, the online, you know, you can rent a film and stream it online in your living room, have a very real business problem, which is if you can recommend to someone, hey, you've watched these five films, you'd probably also really like this one, they're going to make more money and they're going to have happier consumers because you're recommending films that are relevant to people. And they said, you know, that's quite a sticky mathematical problem. How do you use all the data you've got about films people have watched to say, well, if you like this, you also like that? And they decided to solve the problem by putting up $1 million, recognising that a good solution was going to make them a lot more than $1 million. But also that was a large enough number to attract some pretty fierce competition over a couple of years, where people took the data they put in the public domain and tried to crack the solution. Apparently, one of the hardest films to, you know, that broke a lot of the algorithms was Yahoo Serious, because you just couldn't tell who was going to like that film. It very, very much polarised people. This trend has continued, and there's a company that we've been doing some work with, a small Australian startup, but it's actually playing on the international stage at the moment, is called Kaggle. And what Kaggle have done is said, let's make data mining into a sport. Let's get a healthy dose of competition. Deloitte recently hosted and sponsored a competition, which I'll talk about in a sec, but they're taking all manner of competitions and putting prizes up there. Now, they've recently won the right to represent the Heritage Health Prize, which is a $3 million prize, but they've also hosted competitions where the prize is a DVD. And the thing is that even when the prize is a DVD, you get some fantastic data miners all competing and blogging about it and developing new intellectual property. Because it taps into the fundamental aspect of human psychology, which is if you turn something into a game, people will flock to it. Do you know there's more people playing Farmville on Facebook than there are Twitter accounts? It's bizarre, right? You know, if they want to keep the floors clean in a men's urinal, they put a little picture of a fly there and you turn it into a game and all of a sudden everyone, you know, behaves themselves. There's a car that's just been released in America. It's a little bit like the Tamagotchi concept, that if you're driving it in an eco-friendly fashion, a little tree grows on your dashboard. So everyone's suddenly slowing down because they want the tree to grow. It's better for the environment. This concept of the game layer or of gamification is a really interesting one to hook into. And it's especially those concepts where you mix reality and the virtual world perfectly in a game type of layer. So using our enabled devices and the geocoding aspects of those that really allow something to go viral and effectively take off. And Kaggle have done that pretty well. And an example which I really like is there was a problem to do with gene binding in with HIV. And the academic best efforts at predicting the gene binding tendencies in some complex data set was 70%, and all the literature was published around 70%, and no one could do any better than that in universities. And they put it out there, and in a week, the general public had beat the academically accepted best prediction. They were at 72% in a week, and the competition finished with a 10% improvement on what the best academics had been able to do just by crowdsourcing this analytics problem. Which is really neat. And in fact, most problems that have made their way onto Kaggle and why we're so excited to work with them smash through the boundaries so quickly because they've got such an incredibly diverse bunch of people who are competing, who are hooked into this network and who are now starting to, you know, feed off with one another. There's, oh, the Netflix guys are you know, winning this competition, then someone else takes over the next morning. So you can see it's a really diverse bunch of skill sets, but what's even more interesting is who's winning. So you've got your big teams from MIT and from the SAS Institute and from big software companies and IBM, and then the prizes are being taken by some 21-year-old undergraduate student at a university you've never heard of in some Eastern Bloc country. So it really does allow different ways of solving a problem, a real-world problem, to be applied and to find their way to the forefront. So in addition to working with Kaggle, how do we crowdsource at Deloitte? Well, this is a social media platform called Yammer. It's kind of like Twitter for inside an organisation. It very simply asks, what are you working on? And people follow you and you build your own little networks and there are groups and all the rest of it. But what it's done is it's flattened the organisation. So you've got the CEO of a 5,000 employee company interacting with a first year graduate, and he says, you know, I'm doing this talk on blah 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 at lunchtime, has anyone got any ideas? And there's this guy that, you know, in an organisation would have never met or chatted with the CEO at his junior rank, actually interacting with him, giving some really good ideas. Not just the CEO, but throughout the organisation, you're connecting people, and you're basically, you know, a neat segue into the next bit of the talk is you're increasing social capital by collaborating and crowdsourcing problems using social media. So we also built a little tool, a visualisation tool, to prove to ourselves, you know, is Yammer working? Is it increasing social capital? This is a keywords voyager, and it also appears to be some sort of magic time machine that can see into the future, but there's obviously a problem with the axis. So at the start, everyone was just talking about Yammer and data visualisation, and then the iPhone came out, and it basically shows you over time what people are interested in, but it still hasn't proven to us the value of the collective action that comes through a collaboration package like this. So we used another approach to visualise the connections that have been built between the different lines of business, showing it coming out of one line of business into another, and these are guys that might have never interacted with each other on problems before. So you know, a picture tells a thousand words. This is showing the connectivity. We're watching it changing over time. And what we're actually doing is increasing social capital. So it's a very interesting and hot topic at the moment, social capital. And it's basically, you know, an accounting viewpoint of the value of a company above and beyond its assets is goodwill. So goodwill is the intangible stuff. The social capital is the intangible aspect of what happens when you put a bunch of people together. So the people have got certain value, assets, things they can contribute, and when you network them in a certain way, you create more value, you create more social capital. Or you network them badly and you don't create social capital. So we're creating some social capital right now, but the trick is, how do we optimise it? And that's better for everyone. It's a win-win situation. I give a good example for social capital. You know, the concept of necessity being the mother of all inventions. So it's 1948, and Israel's just been formed, and everyone immediately wants to kill them. All their neighbours want to wipe them off the map. So they've got some very real problems of survival. They've got to turn a desert fertile. They've got to sort out radar and farming and a whole heap of problems. And what large governments used to do was they'd take all their engineers and put them in a room, and they'd take all their lawyers and they'd put them in a room, and they'd take all their scientists and they'd put them in a room, and they'd let everyone sort of bubble away on these problems. What Israel was very good at doing, and it's probably the reason that you've got sort of, you know, third highest NASDAQ listed companies today and fertile deserts and huge entrepreneurship, is they'd mix it up. You'd get a network with a lawyer sitting with an engineer, sitting with a biologist, and they'd bounce off one another. So it's the same assets, it's the same people with the same capabilities, but just by connecting them differently, you achieve so much more. So we set out to optimise social capital both inside Deloitte and also for our clients. And we do that by leveraging existing data assets. So data is certainly an asset. It's an interesting asset because the value of the asset depends on how you analyse it and how you work with it. So the data assets we were working with was our address lists, which told you where people sat, our organisational charts, which told you how people were connected, Yammer, which talked about, as I, you know, who's following who, what are the networks of people that are interested in the same thing, but also what are they saying, what are they talking about. We've got innovation networks, which is collaboration software around innovation. What are people talking about? How are they connected? We had phone records. Who's speaking to whom? What networks exist there? And, of course, the ability for people to maintain their own tags and say, you know, you didn't know, but I'm also interested in bike riding. So, very real use case. I mean, what are some of the use cases? I've got to develop a new iPhone app to do with geo-tagging or geospatial something or other. I don't know anyone in the organisation who's got that skill, but what if I had a tool that I knew that a guy that I just sat on a project with for 6 months speaks every day to someone who's got that skill? I can make a warm connection, I can get it happening. I want to have a group that rides bikes in Melbourne to go for a ride on the weekend. Well, what if I knew that a guy who sat just over there did that? I'm going to increase social capital by using these tools, and the secret is hidden in data. So the way we got to the bottom of it was using things like text analytics, which turns large amounts of unstructured data into structured data we can analyse, using social network analysis, using artificial intelligence, which is a particular technique for data analytics that I use all the time, and a lot of data visualisation, because at the end of the day we're really visual people, and we often say let's look at the data, you know, we don't say let's read the numbers. We want to take information in visually. So here is a visualisation which is about structuring unstructured data. So you throw all of this Yammer text in and you say, well, what does it all mean? And it gives you themes, concepts, keywords that are related to those concepts. The popularity of something is the size of the bubble. How hot a topic it is the colour of the bubble. What it's related to is what it's next to. So management's related to engagement, which is a very hot topic at the moment. And then you've basically started to quantify a large amount of unstructured data through text mining. There's also the network itself. When you connect people, you want to visualise how that network's created, and there's thousands of tools for this. I've personally used hundreds of them, but the real trick to cracking the value out of social networks is the mathematical analysis of things like the connectivity. You know, you've probably heard about the Kevin Bacon index, and there's this concept of eigenvector centrality, which is actually what Google PageRank does. I'm important in a network if I'm linked to other important people in a network, or important if they're linked to other important people in a network. So you end up generating a large amount of data about connectivity. I'm going to get a flashing light. That's not good. I'm going to talk faster. Artificial intelligence, neat way of making sense of a whole heap of data. This is the tool that we came up with. So part of it is just about searching for people, you know, finding someone. It's basically a glorified address book. But where it gets interesting is when you switch it into the relationship view and you say, well, including my informal relationships, including my communication networks, when I start searching for that iPhone developer, how can I connect to them? There's Sarah Brown. She's only one hop away and she actually is an iPhone developer. Here's John Smith. He's actually a smartphone specialist. And I can connect to him through two hops in my network. So this tool really enables that collaboration through social capital. very quickly the last example as one. And I'll let that be explained by the very, very, very smart guy who wrote this book, Mirdad Bhargai, together with our global CEO. As one is about actually saying, well, people collaborate and want to collaborate in different ways. And if you understand that through analytics, then you can have the best possible outcome for everyone. And he describes it neatly in this short video here.
One, to achieve great things. How did Apple convince thousands of developers to create over 300,000 apps within 2 years for the iPhone and iPad in a way that no single company could have? How did Linus Torvalds develop the Linux kernel and get enthusiasts from around the world to build something that has challenged the platforms of software giants? How has Medco developed a way for its 2,500 pharmacists to deliver more than 100 million prescriptions per year with Six Sigma accuracy? How do Guy La Liberté and the thousands of Cirque du Soleil's performers repeatedly create breathtaking shows that combine their extraordinary and diverse talents? How do Marriott's language programs create opportunities for foreign entry-level workers while also enabling the hotel chain to maintain the industry's lowest staff turnover rates? How did Ratan Tata, CEO of the Tata Group, convince hundreds of automotive suppliers to reinvent their traditional car components to deliver a car for just $2,500? How do the Dabbawalas, the illiterate lunchbox delivery men of Mumbai, deliver more than 200,000 hot meals a day with only 1 out of every 6 million failing to arrive on time? How does the engineering company W.L. Gore and Associates continue to be one of the world's most innovative companies with few job titles, no job descriptions, and no defined organization charts? And these are just a few remarkable examples. But really, when you think about it, how many different ways are there to work as one? Many think there are only two ways, command and control and everything else. On top of that, most people think that command and control is an approach that is outdated. Actually, neither is true. Using advanced data analytic techniques, we began to map a robust taxonomy for how large groups of people work as one. We have already discovered and named 8 different models, which can work effectively when applied in the right situations. Why is this important? The challenge is that you cannot get large groups of people to work as one if they have different interpretations about how they are supposed to work together. For the first time, we have a clear language to help leaders test whether their people have the same mental model about how to work together. Told through various leaders and their people's stories, As One provides a powerful new approach to help you to think about these questions with greater clarity than ever before. As One, individual action, collective power.
So I guess the takeaway from that is that you're bringing a science that's analytically based to say, well, there are different ways that collective action can healthily function and that you can fine-tune it, and there's not one right way and one wrong way, and crowdsourcing might be a community organiser and volunteer, bottom-up kind of structure, whereas landlord and tenants is what allows Apple to be so effective in the App Store, which is very much a top-down directive structure. There are structures that are more scripted, and there are structures that are more creative, and then you've sort of got your hybrid models. And in fact, the inspiration for architect and builders was the Opera House itself and its design. So just in closing, to recap, we empower collective action to allow people to function as one using analysis and social capital maximization. The game layer is very important. If you can hook into that, you're going to do well. Visualization is a key tool to use. Another important point, dog food is very tasty. It's a good way to go to do to yourself what you want others to do to you. And in that vibe, that statisticians are sexy. And finally, one of my favourite tweets of recent times from Adam Reid, when we were talking about As One at a Google conference, when did Deloitte get cool? Well, Adam Reid, you're a bit out of touch. We've been cool for some time, so... Thank you very much.